Each week at this time, WJTN is happy to present A Little Night Music, featuring concert, jazz, and popular music, principally from the personal collection of the host, Miles Lasser, who hopes to share with you his longtime interest in and opinions about music of all kinds. And now, here's Miles Lasser.
Hello and welcome. This program, along with next week's, is going to be devoted exclusively to the music of one of America's greatest popular composers, Cole Porter. Porter, urbane and dapper, born to wealth, educated at private schools, and a Yale graduate, and at a time when the Yale blue was composed mainly of those whose blood was the same color, was equally at home on the French Riviera, in his Paris house, and in his elegant New York apartment in the Waldorf Astoria Towers, which was his base during the 1930s and until his death in 1964. Porter's music and his lyrics are often the ultimate in sophistication, and yet he could be extremely simple and direct. His work is at times convoluted and at times misleadingly elementary, at times sensual and at times pristine, at times almost schoolboyishly clever, and at times full of the wisdom of maturity. Before we delve into the Porter oeuvre, however, let's hear some lyrics from some of our sponsors that, while perhaps not as witty as Porter's, are heartfelt, sincere, and indeed most helpful should one find himself or herself receptive to the messages they purvey. Like George Gershwin, Richard Rodgers, and Jerome Kern, Cole Porter wrote most of his songs for the theater and for films. Unlike them, he wrote all the lyrics as well as the music, except for some of his very earliest songs written before any we're going to hear over this and next week's programs. That he was worldly, literate, witty, somewhat cynical, and at the same time honestly sentimental is apparent in everything he wrote. Porter's first real Broadway hit was Paris, which opened on October 8, 1928, ran for 195 performances, and starred Irene Bordoni. Its hit song, in which Porter's amazing and unique zoological insights are so cleverly set forth, was Let's Do It. Here is Ella Fitzgerald doing the verse and all four choruses of this now almost 60-year-old classic, which has become a favorite in late-night sing-alongs around my piano after a bit of liquid priming.
Birds do it, bees do it, even educated fleas do it. Let's do it, let's fall in love. In Spain, the best upper sets do it, Lithuanians, and let's do it, let's do it, let's fall. To mention the Finns, folks in Siam do it. Think of Siamese twins, some Argentines without means do it. People say in Boston, even beans do it. Let's do it, let's fall in love.
Let's state the ground rules. First, we'll proceed chronologically. Today, we'll hear songs from 1928 to 1935. Second, all but one of the songs will feature vocalists, especially appropriate for Porter's songs, whose lyrics are as engaging as his melodies. The only non-vocal recording in the whole batch will be played today, and in one of the very few arrangements that I think you will agree is superior to the lyricized version. Third, we must make our usual apology for the regrettable omission, due to restrictions of time, of so many great songs. I can only hope that although I may not play one of your special Cole Porter favorites, you will nonetheless approve what I do play. Again, I'm indebted to my friend Tony Battaglia for the loan of several of the recordings we'll hear. In November 1929, Porter opened another hit show with a French setting, 50 Million Frenchmen, that ran for 254 performances and starred William Gaxton and Genevieve Tobin. Here, sung by cafe singer extraordinaire Bobby Short, is You've Got That Thing, one of Porter's first discourses on the mystical magnetism of love, and containing one of popular songdom's first biblical comparisons, in which the Bible comes in second. You've got what Adam craved when he with love for Eve was tortured. She only had an apple tree, but you've got an orchard.
Makes birds forget to sing. Yes, you've got that thing, that certain thing. You've got that charm, that subtle charm, that makes young farmers desert the farm. You got that thing, that certain thing. You've got what Adam craved when he with love for Eve was tortured. Got an orchard. You got those ways, those taken ways, that make me rush off to Cartier's for a wedding ring. Yes, you got that thing. You got that thing, you got that thing. Thing that makes minds prefer to cling. Yes, you've got that thing, that certain thing. You've got those looks, those fatal looks, that make book censors enjoy their books. Cause you've got that thing, that certain thing. Just what made Samson be for years Delilah's lord and keeper. A pair of shears, but you've got a reaper. You've got that power, the power to grip, that makes me map out a wedding trip for the early spring. Cause you've got that thing. You got that thing, you got that thing. The thing that makes bees refuse to sting. You've got that thing. That warms, that makes reformers reform reforms. You've got that thing, yes, that certain thing. They tell us Trojan Helen's lips made every man her slavey. If her face launched a thousand ships, well, yours could launch a navy. You got that bomb and such a lot. It makes me think you're prepared for what any storm might bring. Jing, jing, jing. Yes, you got the what you got. You know you got. You got that thing. Yes, 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 you got that thing.
Wake Up and Dream opened on December 30, 1929. Its score featured one of Porter's most haunting songs of irretrievable love, sung by the cast-off lover, in this case, the show's female second banana. Here is Ella Fitzgerald again, asking the eternal question, what is this thing called love? The completely satisfactory answer to which has eluded mankind since the dawn of recorded history.
What is this thing called love? This funny thing called love. Just who can solve its mystery? Why should it make a
show, The New Yorkers, Cole Porter inserted a song whose success was almost of the underground variety, since its lyrics were for more than 30 years considered far too risque to be sung over television and on radio. When they're compared with some of today's rock lyrics, they seem almost Shakespearean, but they do reveal that there are some women in our culture for whom love, or at least the fantasy of it, must be a paying proposition. Once more, it's Ella Fitzgerald singing one of Porter's saddest and most bitter lyrics, Love for Sale.
Through the mill of love, oh, love, new love.
It's a long leap from the sordid milieu of Love for Sale to the extravagant romanticism of Night and Day. But who is more adept at making that leap than Fred Astaire, who sang it in both the original 1932 Broadway production of The Gay Divorcee and in the 1933 film that followed it, the first one featuring Fred and Ginger. Night and Day, probably Porter's biggest all-time hit, has been done and overdone many, many times. But Astaire's simple and tasteful interpretation, which includes the not always performed verse, remains the standard by which the others should be judged.
The beat, beat, beat of the tom-tom when the jungle shadows fall. Like the tick, tick, tock of the stately clock as it stands against the wall. Like the drip, drip, drip of the raindrops when the summer shower is through. So a voice within me keeps repeating you, 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 night and day. You are the one. Only you beneath the moon and under the sun. Whether near to me or far, it's no matter, darling, where you are, I think of you. Night and day, day and night, why is it so that this longing for you follows wherever I go? In the roaring traffic's boom, in the silence of my lonely room, I think of you. Night and day, night and day, under the hide of me, there's an oh such a hungry yearning burning inside of me. And its torment won't be through till you let me spend my life making love to you day and night, night and day.
One of Cole Porter's biggest hit shows was Anything Goes, which opened in 1934, starring William Gaxton, Ethel Merman, and Victor Moore. It was not only made into a highly successful motion picture, but continues to enjoy success right up to now, with several productions constantly running all over the country. Its score was unequaled, even by Porter, and we're going to do three songs that have never grown tiresome. Two played and sung by Porter himself, who, if he had needed the money, could have had quite a career as a cafe singer. Here he is doing the title song, Anything Goes, with such impeccable diction and precision that every one of its complicated verbal and rhythmic nuances is made perfectly clear.
Anything goes. landed on Plymouth Rock. If today any shock they should try to stem, instead of landing on Plymouth Rock would land on them. In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was looked on as something shocking, but now God knows anything goes. Good authors too, who once knew better words, now only use four letter words, writing prose. Anything goes. If driving fast cars you like, if low bars you like, if old hymns you like, if bare limbs you like, if Mae West you like, or me undressed you like, why nobody will oppose. When every night the set that's smart is intruding and nudist parties in studio, anything goes. When Mrs. Ned McLean, God bless her, can get Russian red to yes, sir, then I suppose anything goes. When Rockefeller still can hoard enough money to let Matt Gordon produce his show, anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and good's bad today, and black's white today, and day's night today, and that gent today you gave a cent today once had several chateaus. When folks who still can ride in jitneys find out Vanderbilts and Whitneys lack baby clothes, anything goes. When Sam Goldwyn can with great conviction instruct Anna, send in diction, then Anna shows anything goes. When you hear that Lady Mendel standing up, now does a handspring landing up on her toes, anything goes. Just think of those shocks you got, and those knocks you got, and those blues you got from those news you got, and those pains you got, if any brains you got from those little radios. So Mrs. R, with all her trimmings, can broadcast the bed from Simmons, cause Franklin knows anything goes.
From Anything Goes also comes one of Porter's most sophisticated lyrics, perfectly matched to a soaring melody. It's I Get a Kick Out of You. Again, it's clear that the singer has been the dumpy, as he or she sighs, I get a kick, though it's clear to me you obviously don't adore me. The adverbial ending of obvious is a typically lexical Porter rhyme within the two me's. This number also contains another of my favorite Porter lines. Flying too high with some guy in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. The reversals of direction in that one would have made O.J. Simpson in his glory days look like the refrigerator. The singer's disdain for cocaine indicates that that controlled substance had its place in the world of the beautiful people of the 1930s. Here is Rosemary Clooney putting it all together.
I get no kick from champagne. Mere alcohol doesn't thrill me at all. So tell me, why should it be true that I get a kick out of you? Some get a kick from cocaine. I'm sure that if I took even one sniff, that would bore me terrifically too. Yet I get a kick out of you. I get a kick every time I see you're standing there before me. I get a kick, though it's clear to me you obviously don't adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some guy in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Yet I get a kick out of you. In a plane, flying too high with some guy in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Yet I get a kick out of you. I get a kick out of you. I get a kick out of you.
Now back to Cole Porter himself, singing and playing his way through one of his all-time great songs, both lyrically and melodically, You're the Top. This one raises clever rhyming combined with imagery of the 1930s, yet still fresh, to unparalleled popular musical heights. All four choruses reek with the sophistication and chic of the 30s, now so elegant in memory when compared with today's hyped celebrities, mass tourism, and instant notoriety. If self-denigration can ever be said to be glorious, You're the Top is truly glorious. Here is Cole Porter himself.
I'm so pathetic that I always have found it best, instead of getting them off my chest, to let them rest unexpressed. I hate parading my serenading, as I probably miss a ball. But if this ditty is not so pretty, at least it'll tell you how great you are. You're the top, you're the Colosseum, you're the top, you're the Louvre Museum. You're a melody from a symphony by Strauss. You're a Vendel bonnet, a Shakespeare sonnet. You're Mickey Mouse. You're the Nile. You're the Tower of Pisa. You're the smile on the Mona Lisa. I'm a worthless check, a total wreck, a flop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. You're the top. You're Mahatma Gandhi. You're the top. You're Napoleon Brandy. You're the purple light of a summer night in Spain. You're the National Gallery. You're Garbo's salary. You're cellophane. You're sublime. You're a turkey dinner, you're the time of the Derby winner. I'm a toy balloon that's fated soon to pop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. dollar. You're the top. You're a Coolidge dollar. You're the nimble tread of the feet of Fred Astaire. You're an O'Neill drama. You're Whistler's mama. You're Camembert. You're repose. You're infernal dandy. You're the nose on the great Durante. I'm just in the way, as the French would say, de trop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top. You're the top. You're a Waldorf salad. You're the top. You're a Berlin ballad. You're the basic grand of a lady and a gent. You're an old Dutch master. You're Mrs. Astor. You're Pepsodent. You're romance. You're the steps of Russia. You're the pants on a Roxy Usher. I'm a lazy lout that's just about to stop. But if, baby, I'm the bottom, you're the top.
In 1935, concurrently with the Silver Jubilee of Britain's King George V and Queen Mary, Cole Porter scored the show Jubilee with a book by the then young Moss Hart. It starred Melville Cooper and Mary Boland as the thinly disguised monarchs and featured Montgomery Clift in a supporting role. Included were three superb songs that we're going to hear now. First is a lovely ballad of a yearning for love, Why Shouldn't I? It will be immediately followed by its exact emotional opposite, a brittle and cynical romantic brush-off, an anti-love song that we featured once before on our Valentine bashing program, Just One of Those Things, that contains another Porter-esque lyrical gem of stunning verbal reversals. If we'd thought a bit of the end of it when we started painting the town, we'd have been aware that our love affair was too hot not to cool down. Here again is Bobby Short, doing both songs with the insight and verve so necessary and appropriate for their full interpretation.
Why wait around when each age has a sage who has found upon this earth love is all that is really worth thinking of. It must be fun, lots of fun, to be sure when day is done that the hour is coming when you'll be kissed, and then you'll be kissed again. Miss Peggy Joyce says it's good, and every star out in far Hollywood seems to give it a try. So shouldn't I?
It was just one of those things. Just one of those crazy things, one of those bells that now and then rings, just one of those things. It was just one of those nights, just one of those fabulous flights, a trip to the moon on gossamer wings, just one of those things. If we thought of it, of the end of it, when we started painting the town, we'd have been aware all of the fair was too hot not to cool down. So goodbye, dear and amen. Here's hoping we'll meet now and then. It was great fun, but it was just one of those things. It was just one of those things. Just one.
of those fabulous flights, a trip to the moon on gossamer wings. Just one of those things. If we thought of it, of the end of it, when we started painting the town, we'd have been aware our love affair was too hot not to cool down. So goodbye, dear, and amen. Here's hoping we'll meet now and then. It was great fun, but it was just one of those feelings.
We're going to close this first of two Cole Porter programs with another song from the 1935 show, Jubilee, that is not only one of Porter's most famous, but with the arrangement that constitutes one of Big Bandom's finest hours. It is, as you have probably already guessed, Artie Shaw's evergreen version of Begin the Beguine. This is the recording that brought the Artie Shaw Band into the very top ranks in 1936, and it still is as fresh, as vital, as original as ever, a monument to both Shaw and Porter. For Cole Porter Part 1. Next week, we'll return with Cole Porter Part 2, featuring some of his work from 1936 to 1955. I hope you can join me. I appreciate the many approving comments and suggestions you have made known to me. I hope you'll continue to send them. Miles Lasser, station WJTN, box 1139, Jamestown, New York, 14702.